Welcome to Academy of Tone 129.
Yep. Good evening, everybody. Thank you for
Rich
waiting.
Rich is back, and we have a very interesting topic. Where do the amp tones come from?
We do.
And I'm very happy that somebody finally did a new approach to the whole thing. Because as Jim Lill from Nashville mentioned, everybody is repeating the same old phrases over and over. And to me, there is some truth to it. And of course, what I like about his approach is that he puts it in a different perspective from what he would call, or what I also would call, and I agree on that, like the percentage. So people talk about whatever the biasing and believe that this is 90% of the tone, but it isn't. This is what he has shown in his video. On the other hand, if I sum up his video, it simplifies a little bit too much the art of sound design. And this is my good old business card from back in the days, which is Thomas Blug. Wait a minute, it's Spiegelung, Spieglein. Okay, maybe we can see. It says sound designer, okay?
Now you're out of a job.
Yeah. I tell you, you know, being a sound designer for, I don't know, 30 years and more, it is something I had to reply to. And this is why we are here.
Yeah, so today. If anybody in the chat has not watched the video by Jim Lill, perhaps you could just sum it up for us before we start. Well, we are going to watch it.
Yeah, we watch it together. And then, well, basically what he has done is he was kind of repeating all the phrases that people talk about. And then he did, and this is what I highly respect him for, he actually did the tests, like what people say. If he said, is it the biasing? Is it the tubes? Is it blah, blah, blah? Whatever people talk about tones. And he simply went for it and did it. And then this is what we can listen. And at the very end, he kind of comes to the conclusion that the tone stack, which I do agree is a lot of the tone, and the amount of overdrive. And he kind of has a theory where there is some EQ and there is some overdrive stage or clipping stage, and some more EQ. So this represents kind of the preamp and the power amp. And this is associated with different amplifier types like Fender amps and Vox amps and Marshall amps and more modern amps and stuff like that. So I kind of like the approach because it brings a refreshing view on things. But on the other hand, I'm doing the sound designer rant on this.
Perfect.
Yeah.
Looking forward to it. I was really happy to watch the video. I love Jim's channel. I've watched it for years. He's actually deleted a lot of his older videos. He used to do a lot of kind of country lessons and stuff like that.
Uh-huh.
I think he still sells lessons on his site, but he did some great videos about that sort of stuff. And now he's taken to experiments and he does a load of research for these videos. And what I actually did when I was watching this video was write down all the adjectives that he uses when talking about what people say when they describe amplifiers.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought I'd read those to you now just to get you motivated and inspired.
Of course.
So amps are stiff, crisp, sweet, juicy, saggy, flabby, punchy, mid-rangey, glassy, harsh, fizzy, robust, dynamic, mm-hmm. edgy, hairy, touch-sensitive, sparkly, clean, clear, chimey, jangly, and so on. So these are all industry buzzwords.
Yeah.
That people talk about when we talk about tube amps. When you ask, you know, what does a Vox sound like versus what does a Marshall sound like versus what does a Fender sound like? And these are the kind of words that we use.
Well, I totally understand why we need those words as guitar players, because a guitar sound is something very emotional. It's like a taste. I mean, how to describe the taste of whatever, my orange juice. Well, actually, it is not orange juice. It is a blend of, wait a minute, what is it really? It's a, what's the fruit? It's not orange. It's, oh, I have to go upstairs to look what I actually put in the glass.
It looks like passion fruit to me.
Yeah, but it's not as sweet. It's pretty herb and sour. That's my taste.
Yeah. So I'm going to choose a couple of adjectives from the amp world and describe your juices. Mm. Crisp and juicy.
Yeah, this is juicy. Mm-hmm. It's crisp.
Sweet?
It's not that sweet, no. It has a touch of sweetness. It's actually pretty sour. I like it. Pamplemousse. What's the...
Grapefruit.
Ah, grapefruit. See, mm-hmm. This is a grapefruit juice that I have like 50% of the juice and the rest is water to make it less intense. Because, mm-hmm. here we go. This is, now we're in the world of taste and I have my taste and Jim has his taste and I can see from what kind of sounds and the style he is playing, he's definitely not a high gain player. And coming from this, I would say, clean to medium gain side of things, his point of view and his conclusion is more feasible than when you are a metal guy, because then you will find out a few things, which I will show and demonstrate why things are not that easy in his theory. Mm-hmm. So what I'm saying here is, like, I like that somebody has this fresh view, but again, watch out if somebody comes up with such a simplified new theory. It's just the tone stack and a little bit of clipping here and there. Wait a minute, guys, there's more to it. Because, like, taste, it's like a chef. If somebody does sound design, and there are people like, where's Dave Friedman, which I'm probably talking to in a few days as well, who spent years getting a knowledge together that makes boutique sound quality. And if that is available with a simple recipe, you know, nobody needs a boutique sound quality sound designer, or like in food terms, like a chef that is has some stars, that knows more. I mean, we can have some food like spaghetti, buy the cheapest from whatever the Aldi store, throw it in the boiling water, put some sauce on top of it. Yeah, and they're okay, it's feeding us, but it's not the same like with the Italian mama. And of course, we can rave about whatever, the flower is the only thing that needs to be planted in dark moon nights, and then the harvest needs to be at a certain time, and only when it never rains, it's the perfect flour to make the noodles. There's a lot of blah, blah, blah on that side. And that mystification story is something that I hate. People know that I am also into vintage guitars. Mm-hmm. I mean, this is my 1968 converted, blah, blah, blah. And I don't have the money to buy that real 59 that I loved so much at the Guitar Summit. Mm. But I have to admit, this is the best sounding Les Paul I ever played. And when I trust his theory, it would just be the pickups. So my friend Andreas Kloppmann can make a copy of the pickups. I can put it in any of my guitars and I would have that sound. And sorry guys, that will be another episode. Maybe I have to invite Andreas to prove that that is also wrong. I totally agree on the aspect of a pickup being so important on a guitar. But I also know, because I tried to have the same pickup in different guitars, swapping, you know, and I could find even the guitars made from the same recipe with the same hardware, with you know, like my Blue guitars, this Defender upstairs, where I have like seen 20 pieces of. They're all made with the same pickups, all with the same hardware, and they still sound different. There are a few ones that are exceptionally good, and I can adjust the height to the same thing, and I can measure the pickups, and measuring is part of getting some truth, but that's only one thing. There's a few factors that people and even experts can't measure yet. And there's in Germany, there's a Professor Zollner, who is, I highly respect him for his analysis of amps and guitars, but he's also wrong on the guitar thing. That's because he kind of agrees with Jim on this subject, and I disagree because I can prove different. But that's another episode we will do later on.
Okay, yep, get Professor Zollner on, whoever he might be.
Yeah, okay.
By the way, did that 59 Les Paul sell? Do you know?
I know who owns it, mm-hmm. And it's not for sale at this point.
Ah, I thought it was for sale. I thought that was the whole point.
I think the guy wants to keep it.
Oh, okay. Yeah,
I'm happy that I'm in contact with the owner. So
you'll be first to know if he ever.
Yeah, I don't have the money, and I wouldn't buy that guitar because here, this is the next aspect about all this boutique-y stuff. Being a player, I wouldn't go on stage with a 200 or 300,000 euro or dollar guitar. That doesn't make any sense. I'm just interested in tone, and if I get that tone into a guitar that I can afford to lose, because somebody steals it or something, and I don't lost my whole entire money. So then I'm happy. So this is what's driving me. I'm totally interested in getting in understanding where tone comes from, like he is too. But what I'm saying is I try to dig in deeper, and where he is, I was 30 years ago. This is why I brought this business card, because this is 1992. And in 1992, I was experimenting with Bernd Schneider and with other technicians, Dirk Baltringer, Manfred Reckmeier, people that are highly respected here in Germany, Larry Krohmann from Krohmann Amp. He just posted something like old photo yesterday, and we were trading new old stock tubes and stuff like that. Since then, I discovered things that he discovered, but I also discovered there's the next layer, which is not as dramatic in the percentage, but I'm not happy with 90%. I never was, and therefore, you know, my Marshalls here are the old ones because I've started with the reissues, and the reissues have the same values like the old ones. And okay, the values change because the capacitors dry out a little bit and that, but then you can measure those, and then you change the capacitors and you still miss this thing and that thing and that tube. So I learned kind of the hard way that the cheap way is getting me to a very good result, and then it's exponentially difficult in detail, and in the end, most of the time, money too. But it's more the knowledge first. The knowledge comes first and the price comes second. I'm not interested in anything money, because if this is more expensive than this Les Paul, if it sounds right, I'm all in. If it would be 300 euros, I would be happy too. You know, and everybody knows I make signature guitars or signature pedal like this one that you can get for 50 bucks or whatever. And I do it because they sound good. And this is my contribution to the guitar player friends.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, I think one interesting thing about Jim's channel and Jim's videos and his journey for discovery is that he is maybe in a position where you were 30 years ago,
yeah,
or even before then, because it's also important to say that we greatly respect Jim's video, and
yeah,
you know, it's not like he's trying to disprove or prove anything is true. He's literally on a quest for knowledge. You know, he wants to find out why certain amps sound the way they do. And I think what's really interesting is the way that the comment sections underneath his videos now have two different sides to debate. And that's what we're going to talk about in a bit more detail.
And I think it's cool that somebody finally has a fully new approach to the whole thing. Like, of course, it's clickbaiting and it's kind of, in a way, a bit more black and white picture. But hey, what, you know what? Let's watch the video because there's so much. Let's start. This is, I think, the intro. Wait a minute.
My name's Jim. I'm a musician in Nashville, and I'm interested in learning where guitar tone comes from. So this year I've done videos on the electric guitar, sustain, strings, scale length, and speaker cabinets, which led to me figuring out which guitar cab was used on my favorite music. And now I want to figure out where the tone comes from in a guitar amplifier. Electric guitars by themselves are pretty quiet, but when plugged into an amp they get really loud. And early on people realized that amps don't just make the guitar louder, they change how the guitar sounds. And different types of amps sound different from each other. So what makes a Marshall not sound like a Vox, or a Vox not sound like a Fender, or even a 50s Tweed Fender not sound like a 60s Black Fender? Why don't cheap amps sound like expensive amps, or do they? What about the amp is actually causing this to happen? I have a pretty good idea of what affects the cab because of the big cab video I did, and I'll get to testing out speakers in a future video, so right now I'm mostly thinking about the amp circuitry. The thing that makes this difficult is I'm just a performer. I don't know anything about circuits, but I can type questions into the internet and see what comes up, and when I search something like how a 1960 Vox AC-15 and a 1964 Fender Bandmaster are different, people online talk about these details: the bias type, the rectifier type, the power tube type, and the preamp tube type. I barely know what these things are, but if they hold the secrets to why guitar amps sound like they do, then I want to learn more about them. I had trouble finding any good audio comparisons of one thing at a time, though, so I had to do it myself. The first one I tested was bias type.
Okay, so now he is already digging in deep. But we've seen the speaker video as well, and I can basically agree with many things there, but there's more. You want to comment anything, or shall we go?
Not at this point.
No. Okay.
Well, let's first talk about the experiments that he's going to do with the bias type.
Yeah. If I remember correctly, he has a fixed bias and cathode bias.
Yep.
As you can hear, there is not that much difference in his video. Let's simply see that and put this aside, because on the next one with the rectifier tube, I can show you, because I think I have a rectifier tube here, and then I will do a comment there.
Bias has something to do with how the power tubes are set up. Companies market their amps as fixed bias or cathode bias, and people on the internet describe the sound of fixed bias as stiff and crisp, and cathode bias as sweet and juicy. Now, I'm just a performer, I don't know anything about circuits, but my guitar amp happens to have a switch on the back that lets me pick the bias type while keeping everything else about the amp the same. So I played some stuff into a looper, played it back through the amp on fixed bias mode, then on cathode bias mode. How different do you think they sound? For some reason, I felt like there was more to an amp than the bias types, so I moved on to rectifier type.
Okay, how different do you think they sound?
In this video, not much different.
No, they sound almost identical to my ears.
So, but you have to understand that maybe this amp, and that the switch on this bias at this particular point in the circuit is not doing the magic that could be done. We show you a video that I pre-recorded with Julian, our technician. We have several technicians with BluGuitar, about overdrive in general. We come to this, and then you will understand it, because then we also use bias to change the way of the clipping of the overdrive. We will talk about overdrive, and bias changes a lot when it comes to this, and it's stiff because listen to that part. But hey, second one, and then I can give you my rectifier answer. So let's see what he's done for number two.
As far as I can tell, the rectifier preps the electricity that the rest of the amp uses. Companies market their amps as having a tube rectifier or solid-state rectifier, and people on the internet describe the sound of tube rectifiers as saggier, flabbier, and more compressed, and solid-state rectifiers as tighter and punchier. I'm just a performer, I don't know anything about circuits, but one of my friends has a Mesa Lone Star head, and it happens to have a switch on the back that lets me pick the rectifier type while keeping everything else about the amp the same. So I played some stuff into a looper, played it back through the amp on tube rectifier mode, then on solid-state rectifier mode. How different do you think they sound? Again, left feeling unfulfilled.
Okay, comment here. If you listen very closely, I do hear differences. I do hear that the tube rectifier is not as in your face, the silicon solid state rectifier is more in your face than the tube. And what I want to show you guys now is I have this GTM45 here, and I took the backplate off, and I can simply play that amp and swap. It will be hot. I'm looking for something that I can grab.
Don't you have one of those magic gloves that Rudiger used to always have?
If you are a chef in the kitchen, yeah. This is what you need for the hot oven and a meal. I don't have any, so let me see. Let me burn the fingers. Anyway, I will play the Strat because that's my personal reference guitar for things. So, and now I show you a little thing here about, we are in the switching system now. Amp one, because there's reverb. So now I will switch to number four, which is, this is the like the real deal, GTM45 original with, you know, the whole nine yards, KT66 clear bottles and blah blah blah. The setting is very easy because it's maxed out. High treble input on maximum mids, treble kind of somewhere, and the bass on very low. More bass gets more fluffy. Okay. I was always in love with that tone for the richness. It's the sound of rock, very, very classic. So I hope I don't burn my fingers now. Oh, I have to get the towel. Let's see. Ouch. Okay. That's another tube. Did I kill anything? Hey. Ah. Here it's coming. Oh, tubes. Okay, they have to warm up. When you listen listen to that sound. It's so muddy. because that tube is very much giving a lot of sagging because it's so inefficient, you know? When I play the heavy riffs, there's always like a blub, blub, blub around it. It is something I could be that can be very nice for bluesy stuff. Okay, now we could argue that that tube is whatever. What did I switch from? This was a Ultron GZ34 versus a Mallard or whatever, blah, blah, blah tube. All I'm saying is I switched the rectifier tube and the tone is changing. Why is the tone changing? That's the point. Because the zagging. Because the full power, when I dug in here, there's the bass sucks up all the energy, and this energy reduces the headroom for all stages, the power amp stage and the preamp stage, and the clipping curve gets into a total round, less dynamic range. So, did you hear it? Maybe you can edit this video and then do the AB, so there's no time to waste doing that. Okay, there is a difference when we talk about rectifier tubes. Maybe this is a good time to show the and then, for instance, let me show you a different Marshall. This is why did I buy all these old Marshalls? Because they're all different. This is this one, okay? The funny thing is, this is the less louder amp is the one that I was gigging with. Why? Because it was not so loud. And here comes the next reason, because I didn't like power soaks. I was, the trade-off for me using this amp pure without a power soak, even if it was kind of a little using that amp, pure was better than using this amp. And now, back while we are using amp one, get rid of the that's the vintage channel on the amp one in for the experts in low gain mode, and this is how they ship, and all they sound like this. So what I learned is that was the tone that I wanted, and I think I can honestly say that I'm not missing my amps. They are still great amps, but I managed to get whatever tone and quality they have into a totally new format with a totally new technology. And that's the point. Sometimes if people repeat their old recipes, you never get out of that trap. that tells you the only way to get a good tone is the old school way. So this is what I like about a fresh new approach. But we have to be honest, there is something about that. And there is something about the rectifier tube to me, not only in tone, this is what you hear, it's a lot more in the feel. Because let me describe what I understand about tone. The tone is, I hit the string and there is like the energy and the spectrum of frequencies that I get from that one note that I play. And that's happening because there are overtones coming from the string, you know, depending on which pickups, there's more highs or more low end, blah, blah, blah. But this note has more than just one sine frequency. It is a complex noise with an attack noise, with that note and with the overtones of that note. And depending on whatever pickup, blah, 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 that's the one thing. And then over time, that changes. When I play... The amp now switches in between being overdriven and clean, depending on how much output is still coming from the guitar. When I dig in hard, I can saturate or overdrive the amplifier. And then with the decay of the string, it comes to the point where the level, the output, the sheer output level of the guitar is so low that the amplifier is not creating any overdrive anymore, not creating any overtones anymore. So it's just the overtones from the string. And having this in between, that's my style. My music, all my whatever 10 solo CDs, they are using this trick of switching between the overtones from the instrument in the clean range versus the overtones that the amp gives me. And I play and I manage to mold these overtones into a tone. So we have a little picture that I found, which is not 100% correct, but maybe this gives you an impression of how I think about tone. See this kind of diagram? For me, it would be nicer to have this kind of flipped by, you know, in the other direction, because in the front it's lower amplitude and at the end is the high amplitude. So if you would think I would hit it and we start with a high amplitude and then we kind of reduce the level, then this is kind of your Zerfallsspektrum. I don't know what it is in English. It's kind of the decay of certain frequencies. And this also depends a lot on the guitar, on your playing, but also on what the amp is doing. And if you see that kind of complex 3D picture, this is how I see tone. I see, for instance, imagine these kind of two lower mountains or hills. There is like, this could be like a resonance. This could be like the low, something that is always there. And in this Zerfallsspektrum or in this spectrum, you can see this was an acoustic thing of something. I just found this on the internet. And this is kind of, it's always there. And then there's this valley, where there's not that much happening. And then you can see on the right side of this graph, you can see certain notes or certain frequency, they disappear faster. You know, we have to kind of read it backwards. It's kind of, this is kind of like if you flip the tape around where the rear is the starting point. And then some of the higher frequencies last longer again. And this is, for me, the complexity of tone. And that happens in instruments, and that happens with resonance. I mean, Jim Lill did a lot of things about the cabinets and changing the dimension of a housing is changing resonance. And we all know that a resonance is a resonance that features one frequency. And this is something we kind of can see in this spectrum here as well. And that's a very, very important factor in music, because every drum has a resonance. Every speaker cabinet has a resonance. Every membrane has a resonance. Every guitar neck has a resonance. It's a complex noise. Noise means tons of frequencies, not only one frequency. When you play the 440A on a guitar, it's tons of other frequencies aside with that 440. Otherwise, you would have a sine wave tone generator from synthesizer can do that. But no natural element, not even a room, can give you a pure sine wave. If we are in a room, we have resonance here. And this is the... Why do people build musical theaters for classical orchestras with a sound? That is sound. That is sound design. And this is what is fascinating me since I was a kid, you know? And so... when it comes to the guitar, that is the point in this extra. I totally agree with him that there's major things, but to me, the magic is beyond that line. It's like when I hear to his sound, it's like, okay, I know it's a medium gain sound, but when I, this is which Marshall or whatever I'm playing here. I could close my eyes and look at the Marshall and I would believe it's like. And think of this 3D picture now with. That's tone for me, my tone. Other people prefer whatever, more high gain, but even in the high gain world there is tone. I can have a high gain tone. Every day I get up and I'm still happy to invest my life and my time for that tone. The company I call Tone Innovation. So innovation, that's the factor that I totally agree. But if it wasn't without tone, I wouldn't do it at all, period. And the magic is tone. And so what hurts me is if somebody says, oh, you know, amp tone comes from a tone stack and the right amount of clipping. Okay, and the EQ curve in front of the clipping and the EQ curve after the clipping. There's more.
Let's go on and look at the more.
At the more. I think, wait a minute, let's play the video that I've done with Julian, because you don't know that.
No.
We explain overdrive, we explain clipping. And do we have all the three snippets in one go, or we stop? Okay, let's start with the first. We explain what is saturation, what is overdrive. the basics.
Yeah, let's start with basics. This is Julian, our technician, and we use the pedal stage of Amp X to demonstrate where overdrive is coming from. Yeah. We start with
let's start with clean.
Yeah.
And then let's see where it goes. Yeah.
Of course. So I play some clean chords on my neck pickup, and this is what you see in the oscilloscope. And when I dig in, you can see that there's kind of a little limitation already. So we hear a lot of overtones coming from the strings or the high end. But now let's listen to overtones which are created by overdrive. So I have the tone closed. See, this is the point where it starts.
Yeah. What we are listening now to is the guitar going on in the input stage of the Amp X, then going into the pedal stage. All the frequency response,
flat.
So EQ is flat, and we are listening only to what the overdrive of the
pedal
clip does.
Yeah.
And the amp one is just
clean and
being
flat.
Used as an amplifier without any
saturation
magic effects.
Yeah. Just a touch of reverb, but this doesn't matter. Okay, let's increase the gain so we can see. So this is like the neck pickup with no overtones because the tone is closed, and this little rattling is already overdriven.
Now I start to increase gain.
More gain.
And now we start to see here, maybe you play a single tone. Here in the edges, where the signal that was
round
is now modified to square.
Yeah.
And that is what an overdrive is, basically.
Yeah, okay. I show you by playing from low to high dynamic. Sine wave. Decay. You can also hear the overtone disappearing. It has this bzzz, and then it ends in a round sine wave. So this was a clipping character, but we have more to offer.
Here now the threshold where the clip stops is basically one single point because the curve is kind of linear, and then stopping.
It's like a hard clip.
It's a hard clip, but we can also
change
what we are doing here into a more soft kind of clip.
Okay, and let's see, and let's hear.
So let's go from hard to soft. It's visible here in the tone that even
when I
hit
the clip
hard, signal is still round and not flat.
Yeah, even if I hit hard, there is not this kind of ramp which is like really square. It's more round. Yeah. So just have a pay attention to the oscilloscope. There's never a sharp edge. Can you go back for the hard clip?
Yeah.
This is hard clip and soft clip one more time. See, it's always round. There's no sharp edge. And this sharp edge is what is a brighter overtone. And this is important in sound because this is more aggressive. This is more like, hey, I'm not a blues guy, I'm a rock guy, and maybe even a metal guy. But this is, we are listening to only one clip at a time.
Mm-hmm.
Now we have another thing called the bias, which changes.
So let's first go back to only hard clip.
Yeah.
And then we change the bias slowly.
Yeah, okay.
Now back to symmetric again. So about this, what is noticeable? First of all, the kind of spectrum generated by the distortion is different, because in a symmetric distortion, the first overtone disappears. And the second thing that is important, when you have a lot of bias, you basically have more headroom, because the
shift
non-distorted part of the signal is not modified,
right?
Because it's in the linear part. Yeah.
So, and this is something that is also used for. This is symmetrical again,
yeah.
Right? And asymmetrical is kind of a fuzz kind of thing.
Yeah.
Let's listen
again.
You can see one half is clipped and the other one is still kind of a sine wave.
Yeah.
So
so those are two effects that are completely independent from EQ. There's no EQ in front of it, there's no EQ after it, it's just flat. And we are only listening to the different effects. And of course, we can now combine the effects.
And we can make it sound a lot more dramatic by having EQ, which we will not do, because we want to stay puristic. But just imagine you would put on some treble here, you will hear a lot more of those overtones. Okay.
Was now the difference between only hard clip with symmetric bias, second, and first medium asymmetric signal with some soft clipping.
Yeah, and you have to understand that this is only one stage that we show you in the guitar amp. There is many of those stages and they can all clip. So depending on your sound design, you have this kind of stage and another kind of stage and another kind of stage cascading in overtones. And this is where the magic lies.
Yeah, so swap back to reality here. Julian is back home. Okay, this was a long explanation, but it was very fundamental. I see one comment here that a tone generator with a simple sine wave or something would have been a more puristic thing, because the guitar, but I think maybe you could hear it in the guitar tone already. This is a subtle thing. If you add EQ to it, if you kind of enhance the high end, the differences that we just heard are way bigger. So, because the overtone is kind of boosted with more highs. That this was a treble control is all about. And by the way, sometimes when you have overdrive pedals like this Timmy here, can we see this? And there is this kind of, there's no clip. There's a clip switch. This clip switch might change, I don't know exactly the circuit of this Timmy clone here, clip switch, this might change the clipping. Sometimes the comparison is not fair because the level changes so much that you don't really hear the difference without matching dB's level to be, but people put those switches on pedals because they do something. Okay, so To sum it up, there is more than one way of clipping. And then let's go for the next one here.
Mm-hmm. Power tube.
Moved on to a surefire difference maker, power tube type. This one's big because when asked, what kind of amp is that? I've found that people will usually answer with the type of power tubes it has. Companies market their amps as having 6V6 power tubes or EL84 power tubes, and people on the internet describe the sound of EL84s as mid-rangey and bright, and 6V6s as classy and dark. I'm just a performer, I don't know anything about circuits, but I got my hands on this Egnator Rebel 30 for a day, and this amp happens to have a knob on the front that lets me pick the power tube type while keeping everything else about the amp the same. So I played some stuff into a looper, played it back through the amp on EL84 mode, then on 6V6 mode. How different do you think they sound? Feeling a little confused at this point, I moved on to the preamp tube.
Okay, one little comment here. In this video, you don't hear much difference. When I change power amp tubes on my Marshalls, I hear more differences. Even if I use the same tube, the KT66 on the Marshall TTM45, I bought a new one because the old ones were worn out and put them in and they sounded boring. And I paid a lot of money to get General Electric's clear bottle KT66s and the magic from what I wanted was back there. I'm not that stupid being a sound designer and I'm happy to buy cheap stuff if it does the deal. But I paid for new old stock tubes. Okay, I can't really prove it right now, but maybe you trust me, maybe you don't. There is differences in power amp tubes. That's I could show it like with a rectifier tube. If it's how many percent, we can have an open discussion about that. But to summarize, the whole power amp tubes don't matter at all is wrong. And here's of course one thing. What is the magic about a tube? Well, it is what a tube is doing in the circuitry. This is what I learned, and this is why I could get a similar power amp sound, or maybe very close. I'm never talking about identical. That's, you know, blah, blah, blah. But I can get a very, very similar power amp tube sound when I see what the tubes are doing. I can measure stuff. I can still feel stuff, I can analyze with all my senses and electronic means, and I spend hours and days to understand what a real tube power amp is doing. And that's one thing we will see at the end of Jim's video. He's taking a PA amp and says, oh, it does all the same. Hey guys, no, because this is part of something that can be done in power amp as well. You know what? We have a little video about the current feedback. Let's watch this. This is not so long. I show you what happens in the power amp stage. Let's check what we can do with the power amp. We have current feedback, which is determining the interaction of the speaker with the power amp stage. We start with
Zero.
Okay. Yeah, so you could hear at the beginning there was this mid-range, and then we changed to a lot of current feedback to give you that kind of brightness. Power amp stage, current feedback. This can be done also with transistor amps or class D amps. By the way, most class D amps don't do that. Our design is using class D and is
and is using the current feedback effect, but more than that. And the power amp of a guitar amplifier, for me, is the foundation of the whole amp. Back in the days with the vintage amps, they didn't think about preamps. They didn't think about channels. They didn't think about all that stuff about gain. They just had an amp that had a certain volume. And then the preamp wasn't so important. But there's one thing about the preamp. We can have check out his video and then we go into our.
Companies market their amps as having an EF86 preamp tube or having a 12AX7 preamp tube, and people on the internet describe the sound of 12AX7s as harsh and fizzy and EF86s as robust and dynamic. I'm just a performer, I don't know anything about circuits, but I tracked down a Morgan Dual 20 head because it happens to have a switch on the back that lets me pick the preamp tube type while keeping everything else about the amp the same. So I played some stuff into a looper, played it back through the amp on EF86 mode, then on 12AX7 mode. How different do you think they sound? Finally, I could for sure tell a difference in the loudness and the amount of distortion here. But wait, after just a little bit of reading, I found out that these tubes don't amplify the signal the same amount as each other. So what if that's all that's happening? What if it just takes the 12AX7 a little longer on the volume knob to get to the same tone? What if a better test would be to compare the higher gain tube at a lower spot on the volume knob to the lower gain tube at a higher spot on the volume knob? How different would that sound? At this point, I was stunned, because if you had asked me, why does a 1960 Vox 8...
To me, I can still hear the difference. It's minor, but I think he makes a very good point. It is like you have to compare apples with apples and whatever, peas with peas, and, you know, if there's a high-gain tube that has a different factor of amplification, you have to adjust, because if there's less gain, everything changes in the circuitry. And so A-B comparisons need to be, in a way, correct, meaning at the same level, with the same whatever input signal, anything else is cheating. And that doesn't help nobody. If you are mentally biased, then of course, I can look at a Fender amp and I play differently just looking at the Fender amp, because my brain thinks of Le Freak and Country Leagues and Nashville. And then when I look at a Mesa and I'm still plugged in whatever it is amp, and it's, I will play differently because this is, I'm a human being. Okay, now we can talk, only that mojo makes me a better player. The 59 Les Paul, hey guys, trust me, I never felt really for Les Pauls in my life. I'm a Strat guy. I spent years and years, and Les Pauls were only tools until I found a 57 that got me. And then that opened up that whole universe of, I understand what's great about Les Paul. And this was like, you know, I had a new friend. It's like, there's a horse, and together we explore the world, and it's an interaction. And I never had that kind of feeling with a stupid Les Paul, so to say. It never got me. There was no magic for me. There was no interaction. And I totally understand if somebody says, I don't hear a difference. Well, if there is nothing in for you, there is no difference. And I'm happy for everybody that is happy with its tone. It can be a good Silla amp for $3.50. And if this is your tone, hey, invest the money in something else. And if that inspires you to play, anything is fine. You know, it has not... I'm happy for everybody that had, you know, we all have different feet, we all need different shoes. And whatever makes you happy, it's what you should buy. Has nothing to do with price. So there's this emotional aspect on that thing, but there's also facts. And we have one little thing that I wanted to show you too, when it comes to preamp, is the input impedance. Like amp one has a 2 mega ohm input impedance, which is very high. And in this little video clip that I've done with Julian, we show you what happens when you have a low input impedance, which is used on other pedals or input stages, and what it does to the guitar tone. Let's watch this for a second. So now we increase the gain and we show you the difference between symmetrical and asymmetrical clipping. Yeah, as you can hear, one is powerful and punchy and the other one is more like a fuzz and woolly.
Yeah, so I think we kind of showed that it is not only 1%, maybe more than 2%.
It can be essential. And imagine there are so many stages in the whole amplifier, and the mixture of these nuances in every stage, they create the overtones, and this creates the tone. Next thing is the input impedance. We have the option to switch between a 2 mega ohm high impedance input and a low impedance input. Let us show you what happened. Leave it on the high gain symmetrical. Okay, and then we switch. Okay, I show you. Switch back. So what we can hear is that the brightness of the guitar is shifting, and this is because the input impedance changes the characteristic of my pickup as well.
Again, we are not changing anything in the amplifier's EQ.
No,
we are just changing the input resistance.
Yeah. So, and then I show you. So, open, and the next thing is when I kind of decrease the volume here, it's. Can you show the other? And again? So this is a round tone and the other one is an open tone. And when I decrease my volume on the guitar, I can get this kind of nice highs again. But anyway, just changing no EQ, just changing impedance changes the character. Very important.
Okay. And more than 1%.
More than 1%, right. Okay. Yeah, so we have seen things are happening at the input of a guitar amp. We have heard about things that are happening in the output stage of a guitar amp. And there are things that are actually within the circuitry. And Jim is coming to the central part of the amp, which is tone stack. And that I totally agree. Let's watch that section.
After cruising around the internet trying to figure out what's going on here, I stumbled on this tone stack calculator. The tone stack is the circuit behind the treble, middle, and bass knobs on an amp, and I'm just a performer, I don't know anything about circuits, but sliding these knob positions around showed me that not all amps' treble, middle, and bass knobs do the same thing. In fact, it was really hard to match one amp's curve to another's. Maybe this could be part of why different amps sound different. So I came up with an idea. I'm friends with Zach Childs from the Ask Zach YouTube channel, and he has these three really cool vintage amps, a 50s Tweed Fender, a 60s Black Fender, and a 60s British Vox. People on the internet describe the sound of 50s Tweed Fenders as edgy, hairy, and touch sensitive, 60s Black Fenders as sparkly, clean, and clear, and 60s British Voxes as chimey, jangly, and mid-rangey. So I put all the knobs at noon and had Zach play some stuff into a looper, then sent that loop through all three amps with all knobs at noon. Then we started chopping away at what might be causing those three different amps to sound different, so we tried the amps again, but all into the Deluxe's speaker, so each amp was going into the same speaker and speaker cabinet. That worked well enough, so I brought in a separate cab to make things easier, and now I wanted to eliminate the tone stack from each amp and see how different they sound from each other after that. I'm just a performer, I don't know anything about circuits, but playing around with that calculator, I noticed that at certain specific knob positions the line became flat, and it was like the tone stack wasn't even there, it was just a bit of a volume drop, and I could turn up the amp's volume knobs to compensate for that. With all three tone stacks and all three amps set to achieve a flat line, how different would they sound from each other now? I may be onto something here. Zach and I thought it was pretty crazy to hear these different amps sound as close to each other as they did after only changing a few things. But I only spent an afternoon with those amps. If I wanted to really figure this out, I'd have to track down flagship models of the big three classic brands so I had pure examples of what those tones even are. So I did that. Amp number one would have to be a Fender, and if I had to pick a flagship Fender model, it would be the mid-60s style Fender Twin Reverb. And luckily I already have this one that I use whenever somebody asks me to play pedal steel with them. Mid-60s Fender style amps have been used by I think literally all of the studio players in Nashville that I look up to. That sounds really common in country music. Amp number two would have to be a Vox. Their most famous model is the AC30, so when I was on the road and found this one at a cool studio in Grand Rapids, I bought it and took it back with me to Nashville. AC type amps were used on a lot of recorded guitars by the Beatles, Queen, and Brad Paisley. And amp number three would have to be a Marshall, maybe the most iconic amp company in rock music. And while I was visiting one of my friends, he said he wasn't using his Marshall very much and I could borrow it for the summer to help solve this puzzle. It's a Marshall JVM 410H head with a 1960 AV 412 cab. And according to the manual, its crunch channel and green mode makes the circuit like a JMP Era 100 watt head from the 70s. Think AC/DC, Lynyrd Skynyrd, and Van Halen. I already had evidence that EQ matters and the amp's distortion matters, so I thought it'd be a good idea to see if it matters which order those two things happen. Cool, so that means I need to find out where distortion happens in the amps and where EQ happens in the amps. I found out that people who know what they're doing use computers to figure that kind of stuff out, and another guy already did that for a Marshall amp, so I got lucky there. Then I got a hold of a Windows laptop and tried doing the same thing with a Fender that someone else drew up and I simply downloaded and analyzed.
Okay, let me do a little comment here. I'm just a musician who has no understanding of any electronics and stuff. I have, this guy is digging in deeper than a standard musician. Mm-hmm. And so my respect for doing that, because the tone stack calculator, of course, everybody uses that. We have this kind of simulation of schematics so we can check what our
schematic is doing before we implement it and actually build a prototype, a spider thing, so we can measure and think about things. On the tone stack, this is what we will hear in a minute here. As we could hear the different amps, there is probably the most recognizable character change. And if you look at a tone stack, it's pretty obvious, because what a tone stack is doing, think of that picture with that panorama of the frequency curve. A tone stack kind of gives you a high end, a mid range, and a low end. And since the whole thing has something to do with phase, it has notches. And when you have a noise, and you filter it with a certain character, especially in the mid-range, that becomes very recognizable. It's like, I know that noise. And the notches that come from the high end, there's two notches in a classic tone stack, because there's a bass, there's a middle, and a treble. And somehow there are two notches. And there's something happening there. And that's in the mid-range. This is where every stupid person, even the smallest baby and the oldest man that still can hear something, can hear the difference. My voice is different from your voice because of that frequency spectrum. And especially if it's happening in the mid-range, and you know, it's a specific pattern of frequencies which is recognizable, and therefore the tone stack is doing that. And this is obviously the most dramatic coloration of what you get. I mean, there's a few percents of that rectifier dynamic tube and overtones and stuff like that compared to something like your voice. So, and what he's doing here in the video now is he comes to the section where he kind of neutralizes all the tone stacks. And then we get this kind of shocking result. A Fender sounds like a Vox, like a Marshall, like anything, if we just have a flat frequency response. Let's watch this. Hello.
Couldn't find anything for a Vox, so I just did real-life sweep tests with the real-life AC30 in my house. For distortion, I was able to use the computer to figure out the Fender, but for the other two, I had to get a real-life scope and use it on the real-life Vox and Marshall. So, putting all that together the best I can, here's how I think the amps might be laid out when it comes to EQ and distortion. With that mystery cleared up a bit, I needed to figure out what the different types of distortion sounded like. People online describe preamp tube distortion as buzzy and power tube distortion as girthy, but both are praised as being much more musical than the bees in a tinfoil bag that is solid state distortion. But come to think of it, I've never heard preamp tube distortion by itself, or power tube distortion by itself, or even the dreaded solid state distortion by itself. I've played through a lot of amps and pedals, but it always seems to be a big chain that's a mix of different types of EQs and distortions. So I tested all the gear I had and found out that the Vox normal channel preamp with the brilliant switch off is preamp tube distortion with no EQ. The Vox power section with the cut knob down is power tube distortion with no EQ. And with the treble and bass knobs at noon, the RC booster is solid state distortion with no EQ. I had my three examples of different types of distortion, so I played a loop into each and listened. Well, this opened up a whole world of possibilities. I was sure these would sound a lot more different than they did, but they sound less different from each other than if I accidentally bumped the treble knob carrying my amp on stage.
Okay, little comment here. Well, that sounds pretty similar, but again, I still can hear slight differences here. But okay, forget about my one last percent of nerdy tone freakness here. As we could hear the difference with this amp or in overdrive, imagine that you have an amp that has something like power tubes that are not perfectly matching. If he uses a transistor power amp that is totally symmetrical, not clipping at all, of course, in this kind of thing, he used something to make it clip, but he used that RC booster overdrive pedal to simulate a clip. What sounds a bit funny to me is I'm not sure if that PA amp with that RC booster is that same kind of like the other amps, which means the current feedback, the eye feedback, the coupling of the speaker must be identical. And a PA amp has a lot of that, and the tube amps have usually less. I'm not sure if something is funny here. Just question mark. But assuming it's all correct, leave it there. What I'm saying is, if you have a symmetrical clip on the input stage and a symmetrical clip on the output stage, it's probably not that different. But if you have a kind of asymmetric clip in some stage somewhere, it changes the tone. And that's the magic about the good old tube amps, because they are not perfect. I mean, sometimes you have to put a lot of maintenance into that, but my Fender Tweed Deluxe from 1957, I'm very sure if I measure that thing, it's all over the place. It is not the ideal curve. And from what I see here is like, okay, he's comparing correct working amps in a, for me personally, boring situation, constellation of tube stages. The magic for me comes with those amps. It's like the fruits. If they're all fresh, they have a lot of apple sourness and juice, but the older they get, the fruit becomes more intense. There's more sugar in. And you know, and this is where my tone magic starts. And this is why I personally am such a big fan of vintage, because the vintage, look at this guitar, the instruments and the amps, they are already on their way to fade. And this is where the art of sound design comes in, because it is not standard, healthy, boring. It is a personality. I mean, it's like when we get older and maybe we are not fresh and young and do the same thing and everything works perfectly. No, we develop strange things. And this is the same thing that happens in the tube amp. When they get older, the values change. And of course, that's why some vintage amps sound so magic, because the reissues have the wrong values, because the capacitors dry out and then they're somewhere else. But what I'm saying here is, wait a minute, it's a very simplified thing here. To me, there's more, but let's go on.
We have treble knob owners clubs. So what if it's not about the bias type, or the rectifier type, or the power tube type, or the preamp tube type? What if it isn't even the tubes themselves that are giving the amp most of its tone? What if most of the tone of a guitar amp comes from the amount of distortion and the EQ changes and the order that those things happen? What if everything else about an amp was done wrong except for those things? How close could that sound? This is the Tackle Box.
So, and this is the point of the video. He wants to make a point that says, I show you guys that all the tube nonsense bullshit is all blah, blah, blah. And now comes the tackle box to prove that the tackle box can do it all just with transistor pedals and a little bit of the right settings. My point is, I've been there 30 years ago, and my tackle boxes evolved over the last three decades. And I invite everybody to have the tech test on an amp one versus an amped one from our colleagues from the UK, because the richness in tone of an amp one will never be found in other products. And I tell you why. Because from these faded, old, good amps, I learned so many things. Zero cross distortion in a power amp. Nobody does this. And it's part of, when you listen to AC/DC, there is that certain noise. It is that, it's a little bit ugly, but it's an extra spice that nobody out there has a transistor amp that does that. Because that only happens on tube amps, push-pull design, when you crank them and they kind of come to the limit and funny things happen. And this is kind of a extra spice in the tone. And that spice, I found out, is missing in anything standard. That's one of the things. But we have a lot more which comes into place with an amp one. And therefore, get your tackle box out and the amp one will kill this box any minute, even though it's a nice demonstration. Okay, let's watch the video.
It was made by Shakespeare Fine Fishing Tackle in Kalamazoo, USA. I turned it into a guitar amp that I built to copy the sound of a Fender Twin Reverb and a Vox AC30 Top Boost and a Marshall JMP Aero 100 Watt. But remember, I'm just a performer. I don't know anything about circuits. So this entire amp is made out of guitar pedals and breadboards. All I did was copy the EQ changes from each of the three real deal amps and where they happen relative to the distortion. Instead of tubes, I have two RC boosters to cover distortion early in the amp and late in the amp, and two Seymour Duncan pickup boosters to add flat clean level, plus a flat clean solid state power amp to drive the speakers. And the tackle box is sponsored by my PayPal email address. If this video ends up saving you some money on guitar amps, then feel free to send some of that my way for spending the last 10 months in this rabbit hole. So how far apart are the three different examples of expensive, real deal tube amps versus one tackle box full of amateur solid state spaghetti with the right EQ changes and distortion order? So what does all this mean? Jim, are you saying that we should all sell our tube amps and switch to using old tackle boxes full of breadboards and guitar pedals? No, I'm not saying that. I'm not saying anything, because it doesn't matter what I have to say about how something sounds. Have you ever heard the phrase, writing about music is like dancing about architecture? People have been saying things for years. What I did was show you sounds for you to listen to, and you can decide for yourself how different or how similar you thought two things sounded and where to focus your efforts. That's why I'm so excited about all these tested videos I've done this year and why I don't read forum threads or watch guitar videos that talk about tone anymore. What if it means that things matter as much as you heard them matter in the head-to-head comparisons of things that most, if not all of us, have never heard compared head-to-head before? If you heard a 1% difference in each of these, a 5% difference in these, and an 80 to 90% similarity in these, then maybe these deserve about 1% of your attention when shopping for amps. These deserve 5, and these deserve about 80 to 90. That certainly wasn't how I thought of guitar amps before making this video, but I'm glad I did all this and have a better idea where the tone comes from. Wouldn't it be fun to see something like this for speakers and pickups and pedals? Hopefully you'll join me in the future for more videos.
Hey, so, Jim, well done. I think his conclusion, you know, he's talking about 90% here and 1% there. I kind of agree on that thing, but for me, there is this real boutique level. This is, we have that slogan, put boutique to go with Amp One. And I mean that too, because I'm living in this world. If you don't live in that world, I'm happy for you, because this, all that esoteric last 5 to 10% or how many percent don't matter to you. You know, there are people out there, they play a pot, whatever, Pro from 19 last century digital modeler, and they're happy. I'm happy for them. It's all good. It's just me as the guitar player that enjoys tone so much. It's kind of a guy that goes to a restaurant and that tastes the difference in the burgers of McDonald's and whatever company is out there, and like, you know, In-N-Out burger is okay, and the rest, I don't even go there. I can eat french fries there, but that's it. The rest is disgusting. Maybe I'm spoiled. Maybe, you know, most people are happy to eat McDonald's or whatever, but I'm not living in this world. Okay, to sum this thing up, I would say, it's okay if, for me, everything is okay with what is okay for somebody. I'm, you know, if somebody plays the cheapest no-caster, whatever guitar with whatever pickups with no brand, you know, brand doesn't matter. We know there's a lot of money being made with brands and these extra values. For me, that doesn't matter. It doesn't matter if it's a 5 euro pickup or a $5,000 pickup, which is probably a PAF pickup now. If there's the magic, I paid for it because I wanted that. And even if it's 3%, then it's the 3% I'm going for. That's, for me, that's the world I live in. And that drives me. And I have one thing I want to show you. With a little setup here. Okay, we're done with this video. Bam. So I can can I simply unplug here? Okay. So so I show you something. We are talking high gain. Let's do that in a straightforward way. I'm plugging using his theory. So Jim's theory means I have a pre-EQ, I go into the Timmy as a clipping stage, and we learned that there's different clipping modes. And I have a EQ pedal for the post-EQ. So
what's the signal chain exactly? Guitar's going into the spark booster.
Right.
Yep.
And wait, something is not complete because this pedal goes into nothing. So now I'm relaxed. Wait a minute. When I get the signal, I can explain. Okay. Again, the guitar goes straight. Oops. There's one cable here. Goes straight into the spark booster. The spark booster is being used as like a pre-EQ, you know, because it's fairly simple. Most stuff to do pre-EQ, you can do with this pedal. You can reduce the bass, enhance the mids, and have a mid boost and whatever.
Yep.
So that's this gives me a lot of options for the pre-EQ. And by the way, this is why a pre-EQ pedal like this in combination with any amp can tailor the tone towards something that you like. So that's the reason why people buy this pedal, and I bought it too. So it makes sense. So this is the signal chain. It goes into the Timmy as the overdrive stage. Here we have the overdrive stage. And then after the Timmy comes that fame post EQ. It's actually better than the name. and that goes into the clean channel. Let me switch everything on bypass so we know where we starting point. So this is, that's a clean tone. Amp one. Touch of reverb, nothing special. Okay. So what happens is I use the Timmy as a clipping stage. Very boring. So I need some EQ. That's what we learned from his video. So I put in that less mids, more highs, and more low end. Curve, okay. But somehow it sounds boring. Okay, I give it a push with the spark and boost. A different clipping here. Maybe make the whole thing brighter. I reduce. So let me try to make a high gain sound. I need more gain. So I crank this thing too. And this gain is on full. The reason why I don't have so much volume, I want to make sure that this pedal is actually doing the clip and not the amp one.
Okay.
Because if I push my amp one, this clipping will simply be boutique again.
Yeah.
So I just have the job done by this Timmy pedal. And okay, we have a fuzzy low end. Get rid of the bass. From the front end. Give it more treble and more bite. Switch off the post EQ. That's too classic. I want a modern high gain sound. So what I'm trying to say is, this is kind of the best I get out of this recipe. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's not shit, but I simply go and plug into my amp without that. To the clean. So, and now I use whatever, the classic channel. Everything is at the right place. And I couldn't get it with this combination. And the reason for it, it's not because of the EQ here and the EQ there. It's because of this is doing the clip alone, and that's not enough. In this amp, we have cascaded gain. I show you something here. The more gain I have, the harder it gets.
I didn't change any of the EQ settings here, just to show you this. And let me show you a great solid state overdrive pedal from Dave Friedman. And you know what? Let's go back for the Timmy, and then I will exchange that, and then you will see. Oh, wait a minute. This is the guitar goes into here.
So what is it about the BEOD pedal that you think is superior to the Timmy in this context? Before we hear the difference.
Yeah, I will show you even on the schematics. This is using one clipping stage with one character only. And actually it blends the dry signal through as well. So it's not designed to be drive only. But if we would listen to the drive only, it would sound even worse. So the transients are still there because the dry signal is cut. It's a nice boost pedal for a medium gain overdrive. But what I'm trying to say here is that's simply not enough. It's not rich, it's not thick. To play metal with this. Okay. I switch this off, and then you see how much. This is like. And then without this, it's like. Nothing. It's totally boring. So. And. I can I bring this in as well so we can compare it? Yeah, I need another patch cable. There is one patch cable. Do we have, so we use this. No, we use this at the output. This could be here, and this could be here. So. We need power. Do we have power? There's no power. I have this one here. Wait a minute. So. We need to switch the power bank on. Okay. Hello? There's no. You know, 1 second and you hear somebody has done a killer Huygen tone. I mean, I didn't adjust anything here. This is like plug in and whatever, middle position and done, you know? So, let us look at the schematic of this pedal. We have this, this one. So when you look at this pedal, you can see there is an input stage with a tight control. This is kind of our pre-EQ, which is fantastic. Then there's the second gain stage with those LED clipping. And there's the third gain stage with four diodes with an extra clipping. And there is a fourth gain stage, and there's a present and hard clipping and treble control. So what Dave is doing here is he's combining three stages of clipping or even more, and a lot of EQing, and all this stuff intertwines. All this stuff together makes the tone thick, tight, rich, to the point. And this, to me, is the art of sound design. And that is pretty obvious with this example of high gain, what we just heard, but it can be applied to any sound, even a clean tone. If you think you have a pristine clean amp, plug your guitar into your mixing console and get an input impedance converter, so you have a high impedance, you can have a tube screamer on bypass,
and then play through your mixing console. And it's boring like fuck, unless you do disco music and want that clean tone with no color. To get the color, you need a tone stack. Don't try to do it with your mixing console, because the mixing console is not designed to do that. Get a standard guitar amp, tone stack, whatever, and then you're still not there. Then you need a clipping stage here. And the best clean tones are the tones that each of the tube stages or whatever stages contribute a touch of overtones, which is not audible as distortion, but it is it can already be measured. It is already there. That is why most people talk about the edge of breakup, where they can hear it already. But even if you kind of decrease your gain a little bit, all these stages already do something. And this gives character to the tone. So for me, the cascaded stages in a guitar amp, this concept of preamp, power amp, tone stack, and maybe extra stages, all interacting in dynamics, in frequencies, in overtones, that is tone. That is creating the tone in a guitar amp. And that's more than having a PA amp and an EQ or two EQs and two overdrive pedals. I agree, you can get to a very impressive stage, but there is more. And this is where I live. So.
And that would be the next recommendation for Jim, if he was watching, which he's obviously not, because he says he doesn't watch videos about guitar.
Okay, he should.
But that's where you'd send him if he were to ask you for the next step on the journey to boutique tone.
Yeah, and for me it's cool. I mean, I like the discussion about all that stuff, because it triggered me to think about stuff again, and kind of clarify that. And this is what this episode is about. And here's another clip that that I wanted to show you that also came to mind. Michael Nielsen. Michael Nielsen is also in LA, and he did a review on what was it, a tone capturing thing of software from Ikar Multimedia. So this is kind of the new Kemper Cortex digital domain. And in this video, he tried to capture a tone of his Mesa Boogie, whatever, Mark, blah, 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 preamp, which is a high gain tone and has several stages. We're talking about what Dave has been doing on his pedal, kind of sound design in this territory. And this new software from Ikar Multimedia does a really good job on that. And then listen to what a Kemper does. Listen to the clip. And this is, for me, a proof that there is so much room for improvement on certain products. He showed it with the Kemper. Let's watch it.
Hey gang, today we are taking a look at what might become the future of tone capturing with the Ikar Multimedia Tone X. This is the hub that your amp and microphones and computer and line in, line out, all run through this guy so that you can capture your favorite tones. This is the Tone X software. You have to play. Your computer, you do the work. So let's go. Now you get to this cool page where you get to review, and you can jump back and forth between the model and your real amp.
Okay, So that's something I experienced as well, because I had a Kemper at home and it's pretty good for certain tones, and I had really difficulties to get stuff that I wanted to hear from that technology. And I'm still a big fan of, you know, the technology and the idea behind it, and of Christoph, who started the whole thing. These are the real pioneers. Now, you know, other companies go into the same direction and maybe try to make it as good as they can. Some might even do stuff better. But this shows me that people go and say, the Kemper can do it 100%. Well, he has done it, and this was so obvious. So I always put a question mark on things. And I always put a question mark on our things as well. That's very healthy. Never go overexcited and think, oh, we have everything. No, you have to re-question yourself once in a while and think about stuff. But again, sound designer history for 3 decades, I still question myself. I still have to think about stuff again and again, you know, with the new MPX and things like that. It's exciting to point that questions again. It's exciting to revisit things that you have done 20 years ago and double check and maybe approve things that you made a theory, and maybe you have to learn something new. It never ends. But, and that's my, if somebody has a simple answer to things, it smells. It smells funny to me. It's like, only if you use the KT66, it's the best amp in the world. That smells as much as my RC booster is the best clipping stage of them all, because when you look at the schematics, when you understand what's happening there, and believe me, guys, he has done the tone stack thing. And even in that software, we can see the frequency spectrums, but it has a lot more. Even on software, we can model overtones and look into the... Jim, look at the internet and check that out, because that's the next level. And then cascade those things, and then we talk again, because this is kind of getting things multiplied. Layer on layer on layer. I had the question here for the vintage channel, something like this. It's a three, I think it's a what was it? How many cascading gain stages is in the vintage channel? I would say it's 3, but you always have to understand that the tone in amp 1 also has to do with the power amp stage. So what is the vintage channel? Is it only the preamp stage, or is it it's the whole amp? Because this is what such an amp is. A vintage amp is what coming out to the speaker and what's coming out here. And the power amp in amp 1 does a lot to the tone. And therefore, for all the guys who don't like my tones, use the amp 1 as a power amp. You can improve your amp 1 with an amp 1 as a power amp. And then, once you are at that stage, you can even AB the preamp channels, and then you can improve the preamp channels of your amp 1 with the preamp channels of amp 1. And then you get rid of amp 1. Because this would be my chill video one day. But hey, if somebody has one of those, give it to me, I would do it.
That sounds like a fun show.
Yes.
Let's get one.
Let's get one. If I don't know, are they already available? It's all cool. What I'm saying is there's more than just simple solutions. And I highly respect his video, because he was pointing up fresh new questions, which always is a good thing. To repeat the old phrase, Phrasendrescher, what is it in English? Phrase repeater. It's like I'm not, you know, the life and personality is more complex, and so is tone, and so are great musicians, and so are great amp designers. And for me, Friedman is one of those, Dave Friedman is one of those who actually brought the good old Marshall tone into the a modern world. I mean, he was not the only one, but finally, you know, he was pushing the boundaries and made people happy by doing his tone. A guy with a strong vision. And there's a lot of people there who don't have that taste, who don't hear the difference. Of course, he is surrounded by killer players in Los Angeles, demanding for the best. And they know what they want. And they challenge him. But he took the challenge. And this is why his pedal, I have tons of respect for this pedal, because he knows tone, period. So, and some people are on a different level. And that this is, I'm not saying everybody else is stupid, but there are only a few people that have a certain amount of experience and got a certain quality. I mean, some people got lucky. For my taste, Soldano is one of those. He had this magic 39K mod on his thing, and something happened. The rest is okay, standard, but it's magic. And you know, it's like Keith Richard discovered the fast for satisfaction, and it's magic, and he became a rock star, and he still is, and it's still a great band. Anyway, do we have questions? So many amps, yes. Amp. I used to use Kemper since 2012. For me, all Prifers sound boring and flat. Okay, that's your opinion. I know people who are very happy with it. I know people who aren't. If that's your opinion, that's your opinion. Thanks for sharing it.
I like Stratocaster's opinion. The point is, test gear blindfolded, hear and feel the sound and the response.
Yeah.
Which is also super important, and you can't show in a video.
Yeah.
And find the one you like, and then you're good.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, it's, you know, here I wanted to show, you know, I gave those sound designs away to my Chinese friends. There's my signature on it. But basically what these are, I just wanted to give them pedals that are okay, because they have so shitty pedals that this was hurting me. And they are very helpful for me in other respects. So I just gave it, oh, sorry. I just gave them away for free. But let me show you one little thing on this pedal just for fun. Wait a minute, there's the input. And I put it in here and I need some power. We have to, I grab this as power. So, and we are on a clean channel, bypass. Okay, there's my, is it on the edge of breakup or? You know, here for example, I put in the boost and turn it all the way down, and there's not much more gain from the boost, but it makes me play different, because almost like one aspect would be a compressor aspect. So. When I play soft, it's kind of brighter, it's like easier to play. It is a, you know, it kind of disappears in the muddiness. No? So you can measure it. There's no EQ change. It might add like 1 or 2 dBs of high end, but you know, kind of broad. But what you hear is much more present than the frequency change. This is overtones. Overtones created by the boost stage, and which is, by the way, a 2-stage boost. So now I add another pedal, or instead of that, I add this pedal. Where are we? We have a tone. Give it some. So this is the one side. I bypass the pedal. Yes, it's louder, so it's kind of louder is always better. But now I put a growl control to the other side. Listen to this. That's the farty noises that we know from vintage amps. Huh? Okay, and what can I do with this control? Bypass boring. With this thing on the edge of breakup, I can decide if I have like a symmetrical clipping stage, or if I have a using asymmetrical, almost fuzzy. Reduce the gain so it gets a bit cleaner. The opposite side. This has about the same amount of gain, but a total different feel. Mm-hmm. To me, the left side with no growl, it's standard. It's very articulate. Okay. And the growl side, this one, I reduced the gain to be fair. The low note fart out. Yeah, but this is what I was talking earlier. It's about, I like that kind of matching. And here with this pedal, you can even blend between the two. That's tone to me. And no tone is plugging into the mixing console direct. I mean, just for fun, we can do this as the one of the last tone experiments, because this is like something that reminds you of how it could be. Okay, let's use channel 1.
Well, this is the David Gilmour trick as well, isn't it?
Yeah, but he knows how to process it in the right way and get wait a minute, I have to crank. What is it? Ah, I need to put this maybe here. I tell you something, this is no fun. Okay, I can improve high impedance input, whereas a patch cable... Wait a minute, we have tons of patch cables. Zack! And here comes the buffer only. Tube Screamer as a buffer amp. So that's the David Gilmour trick,
you know.
Okay, the talking impedance from sounds kaput straight into your mixing console. So don't try to do this. And then try to EQ it. I mean, this is what people try to do then next. It's like, okay, this is my sound, and then it sounds so dull, I need high end. I need mids, because I'm missing everything. Bass to... That's no tone. Even with the help of EQ. Impedance gets my guitar pickups alive. Mm-hmm. I didn't change anything on the mixing board. I just put a buffer in there. Fucking buffer changes impedance. No boost, no nothing. Okay, so that's sound design.
Sound design in a nutshell. One last question, which I think is an interesting one.
Yep.
Why is it that some amps are more audible than others in a band context, although the sound and the volume is the same when you hear them independently? As an example, this person once tried out a Kemper with a JCM 800 profile, no cabinet, which disappeared when with the other instruments. However, the real JCM 800 with the same cab cuts through.
Yeah.
Why?
Okay. One thing I would say is if you have an analog amp, the transience is like I hit the string, bang, and they are amplified in the preamp stage and in the power amp stage and whatever, and they hit the speaker as fast as possible. In a digital product in general, they are converted from analog to digital, they are processed and they are reconverted from digital to analog, and then they hit the speaker. Something happens there. It's called latency, but somehow something is missing. Then we come to the algorithm. In the algorithm of a digital product, we have, it sounds like aliasing effect. So to get rid of the aliasing, those guys have to do oversampling to blah, blah, blah. Doesn't matter. There is by nature something you have to take care of to get a pristine frequency dynamic behavior, and especially when you have overdrive, overtones, this gets into the zone where you get the aliasing effect. The aliasing effect are tones that unwanted tones. I'll do an episode on this one day. I can show you how to kill any modeler. Just push it with some high end with the EQ here, and they all go wee, 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 wee. I've been there. And that's a fun episode. Okay, anyway. What I try to say here is there is something in the algorithm that has to be under control, and that is not helping the directness and punch. So the next question is, are the frequencies really the same? Maybe they are, because this is something a Kemper can really do probably pretty precisely. So what happens there is the overall frequency spectrum under full load signal, under full overdrive spectrum, all the energy is pretty much the same. But the dynamic, what happens underneath, is not the same
like on the tube amp. They are trying to get there, but it is not the same. So when you hit and play a chuck chuck rhythm guitar, something like that, the information is not 100% all the time. No, it's a dynamic process. And if the transients, which are totally fast on an analog amp, and the dynamic overtones created by whatever is doing the overtones in the stages is accurate and as dynamic, it hits you like a snare drum. It hurts in a way. And an electronic drum kit, I mean, this is a hard comparison. It is something like, it sounds the same maybe at velocity 100, but it doesn't cut through like the real drum. The real drum is more dynamic. And if you have the same volume, this dynamic of the analog amp shows. And in the digital world, you have to push the volume to get to the zone where there is still this kind of dynamic that you play with. You know, a good drummer knows how to hit the snare in the way that it's in the band, but still, when he does an accent, you know, groove, then there's the accent. Imagine you have an electronic drum kit and the electronic mic, you know, the color is always the same. There is not that much difference. I know that stuff also gets better every day, but it's still coming from two worlds. And for me, it's not there yet. And that's what's happening in this situation here.
Yeah, so that's a good answer. And definitely we need to do a show on that where you can actually show that with
audio samples in the future.
I will
be killed by all my modeling friends.
Yeah, but you got to do it anyway.
I have to do it anyway. I've done some modeling in the Cubase. My name is on the list. If you have a Cubase, you can hear one of my amps is actually in there, sound alike. Digital model of my Plexus here. It's not that bad, but yeah. Anyway, it's good for free software. You know, you can upload it. I sometimes use it myself for demos, but I would not, it's not my thing to play on stage. I wouldn't play an electronic drum kit myself either. Anyway.
Yes. Well, there we go. We'll bring in someone who plays digital on stage.
Yeah.
Get them up against you, get a bit of a fight going on. And
And I punch him.
Yeah.
My impact. And here is, maybe there's an advantage of the digital technology. If you don't have that kind of dynamic that exceeds a certain limit, you can play a tea party easily, because the sound is always staying in that kind of frame. If you have a snare drum and the guy who plays it doesn't know how to hit it right, every hit is different. It's like boom, ping, you know, inconsistency. As if you trigger the perfect sample every time you hit this, you actually hit the skin, and there's not so many changes, it's way easier to play. So with dynamics and tone changes, there comes responsibility for tone. And for me, that's the magic. This is why I love that the wider that dynamic spectrum and the overtone spectrum I can influence by my playing, the more it's me personally.
Yeah.
So that's my Mr. Dynamic Tone thing. And it always been like that. Fascinates me.
Yeah. Poo Ninja says Blug Wars coming to Academy of Tone in 2023. So make sure you're subscribed to the channel.
Ah, yeah.
So you don't miss any of those episodes.
Absolutely. Yeah. Yeah. Any other questions at this point?
I think for today we're good.
Yeah.
As usual, there's loads coming up, but we hold these ideas for future episodes.
Yeah. I mean, it's always good to do episodes like that because there's more ideas popping up. And here, before I forget, guys, tomorrow I'll be at the VIP guitar with Horst Keller on the German channel. So if you, wenn Sie mich Deutsch reden hören wollen, dann tun Sie das morgen um 5 Uhr bei VIP Guitar. Tomorrow, 5 o'clock, I'm at, you can find this on, I did a post on Facebook and Instagram. So, and I will talk more about playing than amps. Tonight was the amp episode, and tomorrow is the music playing episode in German with Horst Keller. Okay, I think we leave it here for now, and I hope you learned there's a bit more than EQ, tone stack, and overdrive. Although that is the foundation, and there's nothing wrong about that, but welcome to the next level. This is where we live. Cheers.